Morning, Northridge. It's the time of year where I feel like I kind of have to reintroduce myself. You probably don't recognize me with my burly, manly mustache, but I am David, and same guy you've had all these other weeks. It's just like almost like a totally different person. You think this would be warm enough to keep me like thick enough to keep you warm, but I'm freezing, so I'm going to wear this jacket today as well. But yeah, I just felt like you might be worried about who is this guy up in front of us, and should we trust what he has to say to me? Yes, it's me. Good morning. I want to pray for us for a couple of things. First, I want to give you a little update on Greg. We've been praying. I know a lot of you have really been going hard praying for him. Got an update of his progress. His arms are moving like crazy. He's not able to speak. I haven't heard about his legs, but he's able to move his arms, which is wonderful. There's a lot of concern that he would not be able to move his arms. So that's good. And then the other thing I think that is even more key is his spirit has changed. He was really struggling with really depression about his state, the state he was in. We've talked about how Judy has just been so strong, so joyful, but Greg really got hit hard by all of this. But there's been a change. There's been a change in his spirit, and he has his hope. He's got that twinkle in his eye again. So we want to give glory to God for that change that we see in Greg. The other thing I want to pray for today is, today we're going to be talking about anxiety. And I know that for a lot of people, we give a lot of power to anxiety in our lives. I believe that the world today has given a lot of power to anxiety, made it given it some strength in our lives. And we're going to preach and teach against that today. And so I want to pray to our Father to break down barriers that would block you from receiving his word today. All right, so we're going to pray for those two things. Let's pray together. Father, we come before you with thanksgiving for what you're doing in Greg. Lord, it doesn't seem maybe like a big deal to be able to move your arms when we can dance right now. But for Greg to have that little minor step forward, Lord, we thank you. We celebrate your work. We celebrate the care he's being given and the people watching over him. Lord, we pray that you just continue to minister to him. Lord, we thank you for the breakthrough in his spirit, that something has switched, that he's starting to look at things from a different perspective. And so we thank you for that. We know that that's a blessing to his wife, Judy. And we continue to cover her in prayer, Lord. Give her your strength, your wisdom, your peace, and your joy. Thank you, Father. And Lord, we pray over this morning. We know that your word is amazing. And so today, Lord, we're going to be sharing your word, the word that you inspire, the word that you have for us. We thank you, Father, that your word isn't just ancient. It's ancient, it's present tense, and it is future-minded. It is eternal. And so, Father, we thank you for your eternal word and its eternal application. Lord, I pray against the schemes of the enemy, who we may even be now whispering in the ears of people that David doesn't know what you're going through. He doesn't know the reasons you're anxious. He doesn't know the unhealth of your mind right now. He doesn't know what you're going through. Lord, I pray against that, because we serve a God who is greater. We serve a God who is greater than any physical, mental, social, relational, spiritual ailment we have. You are King of all. So break through this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So today is the last. Oh, I've got my keys. That's not going to help me kind of click through the thing. It's amazing what you have when you wear your jacket. I should do this more often. Today is the last in our four-week series on Philippians. And again, we've been doing a chapter a week. This is chapter 4. So if you've got your Bibles, It looks as though we're going to be able to see the screen. The sun is cooperating. It's blinding me, but that's okay. It's kind of warm, yeah. This is week 4, so we're on Philippians 4, if you want to turn in your Bible. And we're really going to zero in on just one section of Philippians 4. And we're going to kind of give it a laser focus today. Here's the big idea, or our introduction. I changed the way I want to say this. So anxiety is the product of holding on to burdens that we weren't meant to carry. Peace comes from giving it to God. Now, church, I get how probably overly simple this sounds, and perhaps naive. That's one of the reasons I pray against what the enemy might be whispering to you right now. Because I know that some of us have bought into the lie that your anxieties, those things that are just are crippling you, that the fear that you have in your life, that is something that is a part of you, that is something about who you are. And it's not something that can be wished away with a prayer. But I want to present to you today an argument from God that is contrary to that thought. That anxiety is something that we hold on to, and it's not meant to be held on to us, by us, excuse me. It's meant to be given to God. All right, and let me give you some text to show that. So we're in Philippians 4. This is 4 to 7 is where we're going to start. We're going to do this in two chunks. Let's start here. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Stop. How well do we do that? How well do you look for reasons to rejoice? Some people do it really, really well. You know the people. You know the people that you can predict that when you sit down and have a conversation with them, they're going to come up with 100 good things about everything, and they're going to complain about nothing. Can you picture somebody in your mind like that right now? Where they just seem to be joyful and positive, and sometimes it might even feel a little bit contrived. It might feel a little bit put on. But you can see this in them, this idea that they are rejoicing in the Lord always. They've always got something to be thankful for. They've always got something to celebrate. And this is worded in a way that is essentially a command. We are being told to do this. Rejoice in the Lord always. Let's give you a little context, or a reminder of context. This is written by Paul, and he is likely under house arrest at this point, which doesn't sound as bad as being in a dungeon or anything like that. But he is a candidate for execution. If you think back to who Paul was Saul. We know this about Paul. So when he had the name Saul, he was a leader against the Christian movement. His job was to supervise executions and jailings for people who believed that Jesus was the Son of God. That was his job. Well, he had this encounter with Christ. His name was changed from Saul to Paul. And he became one of those very people that he was persecuting. And now, at the point of writing this, he is under house arrest, awaiting some kind of a verdict as to whether or not he should in fact be executed for what he's believing and teaching. So when you think of that and realize that he's saying, rejoice in the Lord always, again, I'll say rejoice. You need to realize this is coming from a position. This guy is not on a yacht in the Mediterranean saying, hey, live it up. This is great. We've got reasons to be happy about everything. Look at me. He's waiting to find out whether or not he's going to live or die because of this message. I had a really neat interaction last week after church. I can't remember if I asked permission to share this person's name, so I won't give their name. But remember we finished with a point of remembrance. And this fellow came up to me after. He says, I got to tell you a story. He was you'll be able to relate to this in a huge way. He's got a young family, and he's got a demanding job, and there was just this weight and burden for what he was walking through. He was just feeling it. You know how you get just, it kind of all piles up, and you just kind of feel that weight. And there's that stress and anxiety that goes along with that. And he was feeling it, it was almost like at a fever pitch in his life, where he was actually on the way to church, just feeling that weight. And then he picked up his mother-in-law to bring her to church with them. And she told him the story of the night witches. I don't know if you saw that I posted a little snippet of that story. And you're thinking, why are we teaching about witches in church? This is in response to our Remembrance Day ceremony. There was this group of Russian women called the Night Witches. And I gotta give you some context. His mother-in-law was telling him this story in the car ride to church. Okay? So these Night Witches helped in the war. They had these crop dusters. And I didn't realize that crop dusters were basically built out of wood and canvas. So these are not like bulletproof planes. And they would fly these planes low enough they'd be under the radar. Also low enough so they could take the bombs they were carrying on their laps and drop them out the window onto enemy targets. And all of a sudden, kind of this feeling of conviction fell on. I was like, who am I to complain or be stressed out by being a dad, which I want to be and I love being, and about my job, and I love my job, and I'm thankful I have a job. In that moment, everything spun, everything changed, and was put into right order, and the things he was stressed about became points of thanksgiving. He was like, who am I then to stress out about that when I compare myself to these ladies, these Russian women, flying and putting their lives in danger for this greater good? And it was a really good moment of taking something that was genuinely stressful. We know what it's like to have little kids. Having big kids is no picnic either, okay? But the stress of life, and when you name the things you're stressing out about, sometimes they don't sound like they're all that bad, but we know what that feeling is, right? When work just grinds on you, and it's tough. But then to have that moment of perspective, that light turned on, that you know what? We actually have a lot to be thankful for. We're going to talk more about that in a bit. But this is Paul's call to us. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. If you can remember that, if that can be your kind of point of meditation as you walk through this week, it'll go a long way. I'll tell you that. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. Sorry, I'm going to camp on this phrase for a moment here. This almost, I'm sure I've read this passage 100 times, but this one has almost been like a throwaway verse for me. I'm like, okay, how does that fit into rejoicing and not being anxious? What's that got to do with the reasonableness? I'll tell you what I kind of discerned from this week. Is this isn't a, like, okay, my house is on fire, I'm just going to stand there and have a party. It's not a rejoice, like an idiotic rejoicing. There is a reasonableness to this rejoicing. And this statement sets up the next part perfectly. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. There is a reason for this hope and joy within us. This isn't just a, I don't know, that sometimes people can kind of walk around oblivious. I can tend to be one of those people. They're oblivious, and it's not that they're so full of faith or anything. They're just not really paying attention, right? But we're called to be reasonable, and we're supposed to let our reasonableness be known to everyone. Okay, I'm not going to spend too much more time. The Lord is at hand. Get ready for this. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. I'm going to stop there for a second. So one, it's pretty straightforward. It's pretty simple. Don't be anxious about anything. So let's pause there. If we're anxious about something, that's out of order. Now let's be careful. If, let's say you're driving down the road, you hit black ice, and your heart speeds up, that's not a sin. That is a God mechanism in your body where you get this shot of adrenaline, okay? That's not anxiety. When we're talking about anxiety, I brought an object. It's an object lesson today. And I'm not really strong. I'm not just throwing this around. There's just a pillow inside to make it look like it's falling. Okay? When we're talking about anxiety, we're talking about carrying around a burden. And we're carrying around a burden that is not getting us any closer to where we want to be. We're carrying around a burden that is weighing us down, slowing us down. It can be crippling to us. This is something, and by carrying this burden, it doesn't help us any more with the problem that we think we're wrestling with. It's just there. I may have mentioned this before, but I was a terrible student. I may have mentioned it a couple of times. One of the reasons I was a terrible student is because I was a procrastinator. And if I had homework, and if I had a week to do it, you know, if it got done, you know when it was going to get done. Okay, on the seventh day, on the 23rd hour, I finally, it's like I've hit the black ice, like, I'm going to do my homework, right? And until then, all I would do is I'd be like, oh, I've got all this homework. Be like this black cloud of homework. And I'd have my backpack full of anxiety about this homework that I had. If I just did the stinking homework at the beginning of the week, I could leave my backpack somewhere else. Anxiety can be like that. I'm actually going to give you a little bit of an example that I'm not proud of sharing, but it's something I think might help you. You're going to be shocked to hear this, but somebody once criticized my preaching. Can you believe it? But I was in a spot where it really hurt. And the reason it hurt is because I've been doing it for years. And I was thinking, oh man, if I'm really that bad, these people have had to suffer through my preaching all of these years. And I start thinking about, like, I thought that I was doing what God had me to do. I felt like I was on the path I was meant to be on. And it hit me in a way, this is going to sound stupid, it hit me in a way where I had a physical reaction. I was driving one day, and I had to pull over the side of the road, and I lost my mind. It was like this stupid backpack that was more than I could handle hit me, and it was a point where I was like, I better get off the road, or I'm going to do something stupid. And I made the call to my wife. It's like, you better be pregnant. And shortly after that, I connected with three people in my life that are outside of the country, and so I knew they would be burdened by the story, but I needed them praying, and it was one of those things that just, it absolutely torpedoed me. And it really stuck with me for a really long time. And to be honest, I haven't dealt with a lot of anxiety in my life. So in a twisted way, it was a bit of a gift to understand the weight of what anxiety can do to a person. Because it made no sense. It did no good for me to be anxious about this. It did no good for me to be worrying about it. And I'll tell you something that really helped. And those of you who know me, they know that I've referenced this book. It's not the Bible in this case. I've referenced this book far too broad. I've applied it far too broadly, but it's what I've applied here as well. And it's the story, it's called The Tale of Three Kings. And it's the story of King David, before he was king, while he was king, and when he was kind of transitioned out of kingship. And God really ministered to me. He took away my anxiety with this story. And I'm telling you this, hopefully that it'll help you too, because I know that a lot of you are walking through some tough stuff. The story of A Tale of Three Kings is a story where David was anointed as the next king of Israel, but not yet appointed. So Saul was still on the throne. But David knew he was next in line. In fact, other people started to know that David was next in line, and they saw Saul doing a terrible job as king of Israel, king of God's chosen people. And they started to speak into David's life, David, you need to assert yourself as king of Israel. You need to claim that throne. Do away with Saul, because you are meant to be the king of Israel. And David's perspective was this. He said, I would never raise my hand against the anointed king of Israel. And right now, Saul's on the throne. If God wants me on that throne, God will put me on that throne. There's nothing anybody or anything can do to stop me from being on that throne. But if it's not my time, there's no amount of campaigning or strategizing that will put me on the throne. Is this beautiful picture of submission to God and his authority and his sovereignty in David's life. And as we know, David did become the king eventually. And at the end of his kingship, there was this murmuring. There was this uprising. And people were starting to talk about the next king of Israel. And David's advisors came to David and said, David, you've got to do something about this. You've got to squash this. People are talking about taking your throne. And David maintained that same perspective on the other end of things. He said, if I'm meant to be the king of Israel, if this throne is meant for me to sit on, it doesn't matter what anybody does, I'm going to be on this throne. Conversely, if it's my time to go, no amount of clawing and holding on will keep me on this throne. God will remove me from my throne. So I'm not going to fight it. This is God's thing. And when I apply that to my insecurities as a pastor and preacher, I started realizing I have a responsibility to prepare, to study, to listen, to give myself to God, to receive something so that I can give it to him. That's the end of it. If I'm not meant to be doing this anymore, he's going to push me out the door. He's going to find a reason for me to go. And somebody new will be brought in and they will do an amazing job. And I'm not going to say that I totally put the backpack down. Every once in a while, if that little bit of anxiety flares up. But I'll tell you what. What a peace that comes from knowing about a sovereign God who has a plan and is in control of my comings and going as your pastor. So if you want me gone, you can pray that somebody comes up and that God opens doors for me to leave. But I just wanted to share that bit with you. But I believe this to be true, that we are called to be anxious about nothing. Here's the next bit. In everything, by prayer and supplication. Supplication, by definition, is this begging and pleading, this humble, earnest, crying out for something. We're called to, in prayer, cry out to God. God, take this burden from me. But then the next part is beautiful. We're also called to be thankful. And those two should often go together. If you ever see in your prayer life that you're coming with your grocery list of things for God to do to you, God for him to do to you, for God to do for you that day, and it's not companioned or paralleled with thanksgiving, hopefully you will notice that imbalance and that out of order in your prayer life. We're called, yes, come and bring your requests, make them known to God, but with that, companion that with thanksgiving. And a lot of that is looking for things to be thankful for. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. And here we go. This is what he does with it. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. He says, he will take your anxiety. You're probably wondering when I was going to take this off. He will take your anxiety and he will replace it with peace. How do we deal with anxiety in the world? In a world without God, how do we deal with anxiety? Well, there are a couple ways. One of them is we medicate. We find different medications that are going to calm us down and take away that anxiety. And some of that self-medication is not prescribed. It's kind of that self-medication. We can drown our anxieties in alcohol and drugs. We can just kind of consume our mind with distractions. Another way we look for professional help. And this isn't necessarily a list of all bad things, but just in the same way that a doctor can be really helpful if you've got a broken arm, right? We believe we have a God that heals, but we're not going to turn down a person who knows how to set your arm straight and cast it and heal it as we wait for God. No, I don't want you to fix this. I want God to fix this. Okay, that's idiotic. Okay, a lot of times God's answer to healing is another human that he brings into your life. In the same way, I believe that a good counselor, good psychologist, psychiatrist, can be God's gift to us and can speak into our lives and reveal things that can help us with stuff like anxiety. But when it comes to how we deal with anxiety, I would encourage you to take stock, because if your only solution is medication, if your only hope is in professional human help, then you are ignoring the ultimate resource for healing. God is saying this pretty plainly. He says, don't be anxious about anything. Pray, and the peace of God, and this is not just the peace of God. Okay, well, that makes sense. I see how God did that. This is the peace of God that transcends it. It surpasses all understanding. It will blow your mind. It's something that doesn't make sense. When people are at peace in the midst of turmoil, that's God peace. That doesn't make sense. That's the peace that surpasses understanding. You'll be in you. It'll be with you. It'll guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I love how Paul says this. It guards your heart and your mind. I think there's a spiritual war that affects our hearts. And I think there's a culture of lies that affects our minds. And you know what? Those are the types of things, those are tactics of the enemy that are so subtle and yet so powerful. When he can get into your head in a way that you didn't see it coming. It's one thing when you see sin so obviously, and it's such a black and white thing. That's one thing. But when he trickles in and infiltrates your mind, it starts to work in your kitchen. It is so subtle and it's so difficult to put your finger on. But the check is this: if you are feeling anxious, know that you don't have to feel anxious. Okay? When we talk about joy, we're talking about choosing joy. Now let me be careful here. Or let me encourage you to be careful here. I know that some of you right now are digging your heels in. This is that hole where you're saying, David, you don't know. You don't know the condition of my mental health. You don't know my family history. You don't know the trauma that I'm dealing with. And you're right, I don't. But I didn't write this. This is God's word for you this morning. The anxiety that you are battling, the baggage that you're carrying around with you was never meant for you to carry. It was meant for you to bring to God through prayer, supplication, thanksgiving. And what he wants to do is he wants to replace that anxiety with a peace that doesn't make sense. These are not my words. This is not me telling you to, hey, wake up, grow up, put your big girl panties on, and deal with life. This is God saying, I've got something better for you. I have got something better than that anxiety that's not doing anything for you. It's not helping you. It's not helping anybody. It's dragging you down. It's shackling you. It's stopping you from going where I want you to go. That's not what I have for you. What I've got for you is this. Have this peace that doesn't make sense. There's no formula that makes this make sense. It transcends, it surpasses all understanding. That's what I have for you. Isn't that neat? I like that. All right, next part is this. This is verses 8 and 9. This is almost his script for pursuing peace instead of anxiety. I asked you earlier, if you know a person that just always seems to be up, that even though you know they're walking through life, they've got stuff going on in their life, why is it they're so full of joy? My guess is they do a little bit of this. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, why did I start highlighting later? Okay, true should be highlighted. Honorable should be highlighted. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable. If there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned, received, and heard, and seen in me, this is Paul speaking, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Carolee and I are planning a trip. It's our 25th anniversary this summer. So we figured we could celebrate. And so we're planning this trip, and so we're looking at websites, and one of the things we are relied on are these reviews. What have people said about these trips? And if you ever want to look for a place of bitterness and venom, read the reviews of a disgruntled patron of a hotel or something. And then there are people who just rightly find the good in just about everything. Right? You see both sides of that. Carolee's actually funny. If we go out for an evening, if we go out for an evening, if we watch a movie, if we see a show, if we have a dinner, and she asks you what you thought of it, there's no correct answer that isn't positive, just so you know. She never wants to know that you're not happy with something. This is your golden opportunity to say all the good things that happen in the movie or whatever, okay? And it's almost like she's got this filter against negativity. And this is more than just an Oprah speech here. Let me come back to the scripture here. When you think about the opposites to these things, it says, finally, brothers, whatever is true. Well, what's the opposite of truth? Well, lies. If we're focusing on truth instead of lies, that's going to help us. Huh? Go figure. What he says in the Bible is actually good for us. That's going to help. But let me take a second and talk about where do you find truth and where do you find lies? The light has only gone on for me recently that the news, the stuff that we're being presented as facts these days, there are very few things that we get told that are genuinely unbiased truths. And that really snuck up on me. Somebody posted something a little while ago about Walter Cronkite. How, almost as though he's like this unicorn, he says, believe it or not, there used to be a man who came on TV and told things the way they actually were. He didn't necessarily have an agenda, and again, I don't even know Walter Cronkite well enough to know if this is totally true of him. But the news was at one point trustworthy. The news didn't used to be a vehicle for agenda. But if you want to know where to find the opposite of truth, spend 20 minutes on your computer. And you're going to find opinions and claims for 20 minutes that you're rarely going to know how much truth is in that. And if you're looking for truth, let me tell you something. This is a good place to start. I know that sounds really trite, but I want to tell you something. You know how I often come up and start with, you know, I'm really excited about what God has for you today. I have that kind of goofy thought every single week. My thought, I'll elaborate, say, I was reminded of how amazing this book is. You ever read a good book? And it's just like, oh, I got it. I almost want to tell somebody about the story that I was just reading. But this week, preparing for the message, I was like, man, this thing's good. This is really, really good. And we can be confident that it is true. Church, if you struggle with whether or not what's said in this Bible is true, let me assure you, it is. We believe this to be the inspired word of God. That he has said that he has breathed life into this in these scriptures. They're his words for us. So if you're looking for truth, there you go. Whatever is honorable. And you could be a good judge of that when your eyes are seeing things. Are these things that I'm proud of? Are these things that are good for me to be thinking about and dwelling on? Or are they dishonorable? Whatever is just as opposed to unjust. Whatever is pure as opposed to impure. And you know what? I don't want to be the morality police here. But you know how when you get to be really close to somebody and your conversation can go there more often than it should? Do a little self-check every once in a while. If you're wallowing in impure conversation, if you're wallowing in impure thoughts, it's good for you to correct that or to seek correction and to redirect your thoughts to things that are pure. It's commendable. If there's anything excellent, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And again, it's funny because I don't know why I keep dragging Oprah through the mud. She's not really relevant anymore, is she? She's not on TV anymore, is she? I don't think she is. Is she? No? I don't know. But she kind of became this representative of positive thinking and the power of positive thinking. And I know as Christians, we kind of recoil. It's not about positive thinking. You know what it is? But you know what? This is not a creation of Oprah. This is God's thing. He tells us, think about these things. See the good in these things. Draw out, dwell on the good. And you're going to squish out the negative. There won't be room for the negative. The negative will stick out. There will be like an odor to it. And you'll realize that it has no place in my life. You can push that to the side. So I'm not going to apologize for the fact that this sounds like just think good thoughts and everything will be good. Well, you know, we're called to think good thoughts. We're not called to think good thoughts because it's good psychology. It's good psychology because God told us to do it. Right? What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things. That's key too. This isn't something that necessarily comes naturally, especially to some of us. I don't know, you can put your hand up if you are one of those Eeyores that just sees the downside of everything. Okay, there you go. Adam, you're not an Eeyore. That's baloney. I'm trying to think of which character you are. But for some of us, this is a lifelong journey of seeing glasses half empty. And you know what? It happens a lot in church services. You can take stock of how many things that you have observed and celebrated as beautiful and weigh that against how many things that have driven you nuts. Why is David wearing a jacket while he's preaching? Why won't David just shave his face and be done with it? It's a lost cause. When you take a sip of the coffee and it tastes good, celebrate it. Honestly, tell Chrissy, you make good coffee. I can't remember who it was. Oh, well, we had Debbie. Debbie was our custodian sometimes, and she comes in and she just goes crazy. Yeah, Carol's nodding her head. And she, you know what Debbie does really well? Is she tells us what great coffee you have. But what does that do? Well, first of all, what does it cost her to say that? Nothing. But what does it do? Now her mind, her heart, there she's thinking about something that is commendable. And now it's kind of, you talk about ascent, it has gone beyond her, and it started to affect like Nirmala and Carol and Chrissy. And it makes you feel like, I've done something good. This is the life, this is the path that we were called to walk on. These things, we talked a lot about peace today, but you know what comes from these things when you start celebrating every little good thing that you see? Is joy. Excuse me. We start to see the good in things. We start to draw out, we start to celebrate the good, and we start to dwell on the good in things. And it changes where we're at. There's somebody I'm going to avoid eye contact with right now that I know is going through a really difficult time in their work. And they've got very good reason to be weighed down. Things are really rough in what they're going through right now. They've got legitimate reason to grieve really what's happening in their workplace. And I don't want to say, just stop thinking about that stuff. That's not what we're saying here. But God wants to work in that space. That's a space that God wants an invitation into. And he wants to reveal to you these things that you should be thinking on. Things that are lovely. Things that are worthy of praise. And he wants to work within that situation to change your heart and give you a peace that doesn't make sense. And from that peace sprouts of a joy that will change things. I want to invite the worship team to come on up, and we're going to sing some songs reflecting on what God's given us today. And again, I can't say enough that all we've shared today are God's words. Well, actually, I can close with some of my own. Here's the conclusion. This is how I want to wrap things up. When we give time and focus to the negative, it's natural. We will become overwhelmed by our problems. When we dwell on those things, we're going to become overwhelmed by our problems. When we give time and focus on the good stuff, and when I say good stuff, I'm saying God stuff. Because he's working. He made those beans that made that coffee. When we focus on the good stuff, God brings peace. And from that peace is a wellspring of joy. Alright? Is that a God worth praising?
Yep.
Yeah, let's sing together. Alright, just in closing, I want to give you two things to put on your lips to go with praise for God. We're called to pray with supplication and thanksgiving. So, I want you to fit into one of those two things right now, this morning. If you are walking through something that's making you anxious, if you are walking in fear and doubt, and you want somebody to pray with you, for you, you just want to kind of commit yourself to saying it out loud that I'm struggling with this. This is hard for me. And you want to invite somebody to partner with you, I would encourage you, pray with somebody right next to you today. Okay? And if you can't find anybody, come find me, find Carolee, or find somebody near the front. Pray about it today. Earnestly, humbly, come before God and bring that to him. And if that's not where you're at, I want you to think back through today, maybe even before you got to church. Think back through today and think about something that you're thankful for. And celebrate it. If you think Scarlett's cute, go tell her parents. Okay, if the coffee was great, tell Chrissy and Maddie. Okay, if you just felt really welcomed by an usher, or if you loved being led in worship, don't let that go unsaid. Why would you hold back on something like that? Be thankful. And be thankful to somebody. Give God the praise and all the glory, but let others know those points of celebration. So, supplication, Thanksgiving. Don't miss a chance to do one or the other or both. All right? And this week, go, rejoice. Find reasons to rejoice. Again, I'll say it, rejoice. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you not next week. Unless, if you don't have a place to go, I don't know if this got said by David. I couldn't understand what he was saying. The accent. But if you want to hear more of his beautiful accent, he's actually going to lead a small group, large group service at the Hub next Sunday. All right? So if that's the small group you want to belong to, you join David and Sarah. They'll be there on Sunday morning. Be blessed. Have a wonderful week. You are my joy. You are my joy.